Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV original webinar series. This webinar has been brought to you by Zydus, the makers of Sunbless 60K, Nucoxia, Decadurabolin, and Ocid QRS. Today, we have a young and dynamic joint replacement and orthopedic surgeon, Dr. Ashish Singh. He has got his own institute, Anoop Institute of Orthopedics and Rehabilitation. And he's going to talk on diagnosis and management of prosthetic joint infections. We also have Dr. Sushil Singh, who's working in the same institute, and Dr. Salim Patel, who's the orthopedic surgeon and senior medical advisor of Zydus. So over to Dr. Ashish Singh.
Good evening, Dr. Niyat Bijlani, sir. Dr. Salim Patel, sir. Dr. Kumar Singh, sir, on behalf of my institute and myself, I would like to extend my many regards and thanks before I begin. So basically, I would be talking on diagnosis and management of prosthetic joint infections. A term that has been coined is PJI. Now, most important for managing a PJI is teamwork. This we should remember. And it has the, if you take the epidemiology, it is increasing in total joint arthroplasty, and it is about 2 to 2.4% incidence nationwide, and you have much amount of money spent on the treatment and diagnosis of all these things. It is very important to know the definition of PJI, and in 2011, it was convened by the Musculoskeletal Infection Society, MSK Infection Society, with the major criteria and minor criteria. And they say that if there is a sinus tract communicating with the prosthesis or a pathogen isolated by culture, and a lot of minor criteria in the form of ESR, CRP, or synovial neutrophil percentage increase, these are some of the criteria for diagnosis of PJI. But the most important thing which we need to know or understand is the clinical suspicion of PJI. And that's where the game starts. If a patient presents with a sinus tract, persistent wound discharge, acute onset painful prosthesis, or a history of wound healing complications, we should keep in the back of our minds that it might be a prosthetic joint infection. Now, we should have an understanding of the patient factors, which are age, obesity, diabetes, steroid, and rheumatoid arthritis. But other factors which can be stopped, like tobacco, malnutrition, a good control of diabetes. These are some of the things before or at the time when we are counseling a patient, we should know that the risk factors are more as compared to a normal individual. Some of the local factors like previous arthroplasty, arthroplasty for fractures, type of replaced joint, perioperative wound complications, some of the operative factors, especially the operating time and antibiotic prophylaxis given, or dirty wounds. Now, before I start the PJI topic in detail, we should have an understanding that patients do present with history of intra-articular steroid injections. And the reports in the literature vary from 3 months to a year before we post them for a total knee or hip replacement. We should ideally buy some time. For example, if a patient has come and history of intra-articular steroid a week or 10 days ago, and then you're hurriedly going for a total joint replacement, you should have in mind that the infection chances are a wee bit more as compared to a normal patient, or withhold a patient for at least 3 months. Now, coming to the pathogenesis of PJI, you should have an understanding that some of the gram-positive bacteria, especially the staphylococcus and the gram-negative bacteria, pseudomonas, are the important causes. Some aerobes, mycobacteria, and sometimes you have culture-negative bacteria. Now, the classification, which again I will discuss about, is stage 1, 2, 3, 4, or acute, late chronic, acute, or positive intraoperative cultures when patient is fine but cultures are positive. So these are the clinical presentations which I'll talk in detail in a few bit time. Now, why is the pathogenesis important? This needs to be understood because there is a formation of biofilm, and this biofilm actually helps or it actually does not allow the antibiotic penetration. And even if you give loads of antibiotic, it doesn't penetrate and you don't have an outcome. Now, the biofilms are basically complex communities which grows on the surface of foreign bodies, and they have the ability to persist intracellularly, and it is not static. It develops, redevelops. It is something like this: the attachment, the expansion, the maturation, and resistance. So the plan, which we'll discuss later, depends on the biofilm, which is a factor which we should have an understanding of. Now, the MacPherson colleagues have proposed a staging system for PGI, which we should know about it. And the most important thing here is the systemic host ABC. If the patient is not compromised, the chances of the treatment plan differs. If the patient is compromised, then the treatment plan differs, which I'll discuss later. Now, after having an understanding the risk factors and some of the local factors, it is very important to diagnose a periprosthetic joint infection. And I would be talking on this and the management, that is single stage versus two stage, and the diet protocol. Now, diagnosis is a true challenge. And we should keep in our mind there is no gold standard for diagnosis. And actually, there is no accepted definition. When you have a infection which is presenting more than less than 3 months, it is early, delayed 3 to 24 months, and late more than 24 months. But patients do present late due to some other reasons. For example, recurrent or repeated trial of catheterization or dental extraction, and patients present with an infection. Now, diagnosis requires a high index of clinical suspicion, a thorough clinical evaluation, a serological, microbiological, and radiological investigations. And we should have an understanding that diagnosis is important as subsequent treatment is fundamentally different. For example, if the diagnosis is PGI, you cannot go for exchange even in the stage one. But obviously, if it is aseptic loosening, you can plan for a primary, secondary implantation in the same stage. And no diagnostic modality is 100% accurate, and a combination of clinical findings and investigations are necessary to come to a conclusion. Now, coming to the history and physical examination, pain is the single most frequent symptom, and local warmth, tenderness, drainage, effusion, fever, and a rapidly rising CRP suggest infection. Now, some of the criteria given by the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons 2019, whom should be suspect. Now, patients can be divided into high probability. For example, one or more history symptoms and risk factors present, or physical examination finding, or on X-rays, detection of loosening, osteolysis, or something which is doubtful on the X-rays. Now, it is very important to stratify the risk factors which I explained earlier, and I'll take you further from here. Now, as you all know, ESR and CRP are the two most common test and a specificity. C reactive proteins, and it is not available. Coming to the white blood cell count, when elevated, infection is ...96% sensitivity and 92% specificity. Both elevated, 83% probability. Now, the important thing which we need to understand, how and when the ESR and CRP rises. Most of the times, what happens, that patient has been... A simple incident which occurred at our institute, a patient had cardiac problem and was shifted to a cardiac setup. Now, the patient was labeled as patient having septicemia. The ESR-CRP post-op day 2 was high, and it was labeled as a septicemia. So we need to have an understanding that it reaches peaking 5 to 7 days post-operatively and decreases in about 3 to 12 months. Coming to CRP, CRP peaks second post-op day and falls below in approximately 3 weeks' time. So these are some of the understanding which we need to know. Coming to the interleukin 6, which has been suggested by the recent studies. It is basically produced by monocyte and macrophages and runs to normal 48 hours post-op. Another important thing is procalcitonin, which is a member of kappa protein family, and it is produced in the thyroid C cells, and basically serum IL-6 more than 10.4 reportedly has a high sensitivity and a specificity of 90.9%. These are some new markers. And procalcitonin also has a good, very specific but less sensitive biomarker for diagnosis of EJ. But it is one of the methods by which we can go ahead. These are some of the things like IL-6, which is produced by monocytes and macrophages, and it rapidly returns to normal shortly after joint replacement arthroplasty. Now, these are some papers which reiterate the uses, and they have commented the IL-6 is followed by C-reactive protein and then CRP and ESR and white cell count. These are some of the things we should just keep in mind. A normal CRP and an ESR in our setting would suggest a very low risk of infection. Now, coming to recommendation 2, the combined use of ESR and CRP is a good rule out test. When negative, EGI is unlikely, but when positive, you should consider having something wrong. Now, it is specific, since it has got a high sensitivity, but not specific. Whenever you have a doubt that the patient has ESR, CRP high, then the next appropriate step is aspiration of the joint, but that should be done in theater settings, not in the OPD settings. Now, one of the important things which we do is an X-ray. Now, coming to the X-ray, you can find all these changes immediately after 3 to 4 weeks also, and other changes like loosening, etc. These are very depictive of infection. And at the same time, sometimes you have scalloping osteolysis focal, that is also pathognomic of osteolysis, particle induced osteolysis. But obviously, if CRP ESA is high, infection should also be thought of. Now, we should not forget our old friends. Ultrasound examination sometimes show thickened capsules, abscess, and ideally you can go for abscess drainage, and here the role of MRI can be ascertained actually. Now, when you next selective approach is based on the probability of patient's probability, and you should go for aspiration. Now, when we aspirate, what do we do with the synovial fluid inside? It should go for white blood cell count, percentage of neutrophils, and culture for aerobic and anaerobic organisms. Now, I would like to highlight one thing here, that in our practice at Glasgow and in Edinburgh, we used to make sure that the cultures are kept for 14 days, that is extended cultures. And then we used to have a talk with the microbiologist and take it from there. So we should not throw the culture and ask the microbiologist that can we have extended cultures for 10 to 14 days, please? The recommendation is that the synovial fluid CRP should also be done, and synovial leukocyte esterase should also be done. And a high CRP in the blood and a high CRP in the synovial fluid is very suggestive of EGI. Now, when everything is negative and you don't know and the probability is low, then what you should do? If everything is ESR, CRP and the aspiration is negative, re-aspiration should be considered if the initial culture test is positive or if the probability of infection is high. And you should have in mind that PGI is one of the causes. Now, you should monitor ESR, CRP within 3 months. If suppose you have a doubt of infection, the aspirate is negative, then leave him for 3 months and take it from there. In the 3 months, follow the patient's ESR, CRP. In the absence of reliable evidence, the recommendation is that you should do aspiration and you should ideally be off antibiotics for 2 weeks before you go for any aspiration or re-aspiration. Coming to nuclear imaging, we have so many things, but the most effective is leukocyte labeled imaging combined with bone marrow imaging. Not the normal bone scan. You should go leukocyte labeled bone scan, and that gives you more sensitive results. These are technetium 99 has got 50-70% accuracy and high negative predictive value. But when you go for sequential gallium scanning, it has accuracy to 70-80%. And when you go for indium-11, it is accurate to most of 90% approximately. So what I am trying to say that it's not just bone scan. You should go for different labeled bone scan and take it from there. We should have a word with the nuclear imaging consultant. Now, one of the newer treatment or diagnosis method is PET scan. Now, it will show increased metabolic activity, and it has got a 91% sensitivity and 72% specificity, but the literature review is not very, because the cost is very high and the literature is inconclusive, but it is one of the modality in which by which we can diagnose infections, early infections, for which we are confused actually. Coming to MRI scans, actually it is not very sensitive, but it should be understood that in cases of abscess, or if you know want to see the how much the pus or abscess collection is there, MRI can be done. It is not said, you cannot say no for the MRI scan. CT has got no conclusive evidence except for bone loss. If you want to plan and see the bone desorption, then a CT, that is what I do. But it due to artifacts, you don't get a good picture. Now, another problem is that if you go inside, how many cultures you should take? The basic principle is all cultures should be sent, all the samples should be sent for cultures and histopathology. I mean, there should be no confusion that you're sending just for cultures, but you should take multiple samples, and at least 3 samples should be taken. And as I have told that you should have 14 days extended cultures. The intraoperative gram stain, as per the recommendation, sensitivity is 27%. They say it has got no role, but I believe there is no harm in getting it done because you get the results and you can take a decision on table when we think of Dyer protocol. Now, intraoperative tissue culture, that is frozen section, etc., these have got a sensitivity, but you should plan. And if you have lack of resources, these cannot be done at all the centers. Now, in the last couple of slides, I did talk about biocalyx. There is one procedure that is ultrasonification of the implant, in which the prosthesis was used to be collected in a container. Then it used to have a vortex in which it used to just get. And then we used to sonicate for 5 minutes, and then we used to send it for cultures. These ultrasonification yield higher culture rates, and it actually breaks the biofilm. So this is what we used to do, and it was also done at endoclinic as well. Now, you have so many things, intraoperative frozen section, intraoperative cultures, you should send them, and some of the values which we should know, more than 5 PMN, high power, it is suggestive of infection. Now, it is now in these days, you have polymerase chain reaction, no harm in sending it. And if the patient can afford, you can send it, especially for mycobacterium tuberculosis. Now, this is a chart which you should understand to simplify things. If you have a red hot swollen joint, just refer to orthopedics. If you're a GP, then do a ESR-CRP. If the patient's CRP-ESR is high, take it to the theater, do a culture insensitive gram staining, and then take it from there. And then next steps, I will discuss in the next few slides. Now, importantly, at this point, I would like to say that we are still, however, a long way from agreement on the most of the questions, whether post-operative infection is acquired in the operating room or not. We use the best theaters, we use laminar flow theaters, suits, etc. But still, infection occurs, and we actually don't know where does it occur. Now, coming to the treatment part, this was the diagnosis. Now, coming to the treatment, what are the goals? The number one goal is early diagnosis. Number two goal is identification of the organism. Number three is eradication of infection. Obviously, restoration of function and prevention of recurrence is the next main goal. And for this, you need a multidisciplinary team. Now, it consists of orthopedic surgeons, occupational therapist, physiotherapist, and your infection control team, and your hospital antibiogram is also important at this junction. What are the options of treatment? Number one, antibiotic suppression. Number two, arthroscopic debridement. Number three, debridement, antibiotic, implant retention, that is DIR. Number four is revision in one or two stages. Lastly is amputation or fusion. And the first three options, I do not recommend, not generally recommended, but these are one of the options. When we come to debridement and implant retention, that is the full form of DIR, who do well and whom should we go for DIR? We do have patients in which we think that, yes, it's well fixed. What should we do? So DIR is one of the options. You should have a short duration of symptoms. You should have a well-fixed, aligned and functioning implants. The organism should be isolated and susceptible. And you should have adequate soft tissue cover, especially in cases of knee. And last but not the least, immunocompetent host. That is what you should have. And several studies have found that actually it makes no difference. But it is very important to know that patient's factor is very important. And if a patient is immunocompromised, you cannot go for a DIR protocol. And it is also very good to understand that if the organism culture and sensory results are not known, don't go for DIR protocol. This is what I follow. Another thing, you had DIR protocol, but you nowadays there are papers from the Mayo Clinic. They do a two-stage DIR. Let us say the example of knee. They will open it, debride it, put the same spacer for 2 weeks, and after 2 weeks, they again open it, debride it, and then change the plastic spacer. So, not only from Mayo Clinic, but there are other studies from South Korea as well, where they have followed this, and they are finding good results. But the essentiality remains the same, that you should know the organism, the patient should be not be immunocompromised. Now, coming to one-stage revision, only one operation, very appealing to know. It has got a lower morbidity. There is no pain disability between the stages, no technical difficulties associated with delayed reconstruction, and it is a cost-effective option. But whom should we go for single stages? Selected non-immunocompromised patients. Knowledge of infecting organisms should be known. It should be low virulent pathogen, limited osseous defect, and limited soft tissue covers permitting appropriate wound closures should be there. The principles of single stage revision, and actually you have to see the total knee replacement revision done at endoclinic. They actually take off the MCL, LCL, everything, and they directly put a hinge. It is very aggressive. And change of instruments prior to implantation. So when we used to work there or in Glasgow even, our protocol was when we used to do single stage revision, we used to make sure use different implants, do a thorough debridement, again go and take baths, have a new set of clothes, rewash new instruments and do it at the same stage. Traditionally started and done at endoclinic, and obviously it has good result. I do not personally recommend doing one-stage revision, and limited scenario I prefer, but I make the patient understand that you do have problems in single-stage revision. Coming to two-stage revision, without any doubt, it is a gold standard because you have the patient in confidence that yes, the patient has infection and there is a problem, chances of reoccurrence is there, we'll put a cement and take it from there. It was first described by Insall in 1983, and the success rates varies between 85 to 100%. Now, coming to two-stage protocol, basically, we do a thorough debridement, remove the necrotic material, placement of high-dose antibiotic and a cement spacer, treatment with a course of appropriate intravenous antibiotics, and then at a later stage, re-implantation. But When you come to a two stage, there are so many variables. And each variable is a topic in itself. But just in a gist, you have to know the type of spacer which you want to put, the amount of antibiotics which has to be put. Again, there is a confusion between the length of intravenous antibiotics and the time period between the second stage and the first stage. And in the reimplantation, you have so many problems of bone loss and other soft tissue issues. Coming to the first stage, the principle is that you should have a careful placement of the skin incision. If multiple prior incisions, the most lateral longitudinal incision is recommended. Antibiotics should be stopped for at least 2 weeks so that intraoperative cultures, you have some data for it. And it is very important that antibiotics should be withheld until all microbiological samples has been taken. And minimum of 3 samples should be taken as a rule. Debridement should be radical. Intravenous rimming should be done. Use of saline, pulse lavage, addition of chlorhexidine gluconate has been advocated, but routinely I do not follow. Now, coming to the treatment variable, that is spacer. Again, as I told, you have static spacers, dynamic spacers. If you have a look at this, it was first described by Cohen, and it is a static spacer. In the case of knee, the knee is fixed in extension or some amount of minimal amount of flexion in a cast or a long leg knee brace. And then the patient usually, they cannot move their knee, but at least the muscles are stretched. It does not get fibrous to that extent. And then you have, these are some examples of static spacers. Advantages: they restrict knee movements, they distract and preserve joint space, but the disadvantage is sometimes it produces contracture of the extensor mechanism, collateral ligament shortening, arthrofibrosis, and tibial and femoral bone loss because it is not exactly fitting what you don't have fitting as you want. Coming to dynamic spacers, it looks very appealing. And actually the patient can walk on it. The patient can move his knee on it. And it's very lucrative prosthesis of antibiotic loaded acrylic cement, Prostalac. It is very good to see. But the problem is the risk of cement fracture, spacer migration or dislocation, and potential problems of wound healing, which you'll see in the next few slides. Something like this, or something like this. But nowadays, we have better outcome with implants which molds like spacers, the Popal G, and actually it is very beneficial to use these, and you have at least a good mold, and you can place it like an articulating implant actually. Now, the next variable which comes in action is antibiotic. We have, again, so many antibiotics in the market, the type of cement which we have to use, the antibiotic dose which we have to give, and the combination of antibiotic which we have to use. In general, the Palakos cement has been shown to be the most effective PMMA, and it is what is done in most of the centers around. But if you don't have Palakos cement, you can load it, the normal cement with gentamicin, clindamycin, vancomycin, and these antibiotics which can be used. But it is very essential to get back to your pharmac book, read in proper, and then understand the doses, and then follow a practice. The recommended dose is 2 to 5 times higher for therapeutic use than the prophylactic use. For example, the minimum dose of antibacterial should be 2 grams of vancomycin, 2.4 grams of tobramycin or gentamicin, and you should mix it appropriately. It's not like that you take a 40 gram cement and take 500 milligrams of vancomycin. It should be at least 2 grams. That is what we do. Now, there is a term combination of antibiotics, and sometimes you have passive opportunism, a phenomena that one antibiotic dissolves, resulting in increased porosity and increased elution of the other antibiotic. For example, tobramycin may synergistically increase the release of vancomycin in the cement mix. So these are some of the variables which we should know. But all these things, you should have a discussion with your microbiologist. That is why I elaborated that you have a multidisciplinary team. Coming to the length of antibiotic therapy post-op, 6 weeks, 6 months, 1 year. If you go to the Oxford protocol, they say 6 months. Some people in London, they follow a year. So there is a confusion and when should we operate. But it is generally recommended that 6 weeks of IV antibiotics should be given and it should be according to the pathogen which has been isolated and minimum 6 weeks and serial CRPs. And if you have any issues, rediscuss with the microbiologist and take it from there. In general, the re-implantation should be delayed at least 6 to 8 weeks. After 6 weeks, if you feel the ESR CRP is low, get him off for antibiotics for 2 weeks and then take it from there. Sometimes we used to even take cultures after 6 to 8 weeks again and then post it for a surgery again. So time period, there is a lot of confusion. Some studies say 6 weeks, some studies say 22 weeks, but it depends on how much your CRP ESR has fallen down. And generally, when I'll show you in my series, we don't get a CRP less than 6. It is generally 8, 10, but get the urine and chest cleared and make sure no dental infection. If everything is fine, 6, 8, 10, you can take it for a second stage surgery. And as what I told earlier, weekly monitoring of ESR CRP is very mandated and antibiotic according to all these should be administered. When you talk of the second stage, the principle is it actually represents an opportunity to perform a thorough repeat debridement and irrigation of the periprosthetic soft tissue and the bone. So whatever might have been left in the first stage can be overcome in the second stage. It reduces the burden of any persistently infected tissue and allows the removal of cement abrasion debris from the antibiotic spacer that cause future third body wear in the prosthesis. Again, after your second stage, send for the culture sensitivity. No culture sensitivity. Go for empirical treatment at least for 6 weeks and take it from there. And then serial CRPs. I do not follow any protocol of giving long-term antibiotics. The principle of two stages depends from the results has been good and is actually a wide range from 9% to 33%. So when we talk to the patient, we have to make them understand that even if we do a two stage, the chances of reinfection ranges from 9 to 33, the average being 18, and have an understanding that yes, there might be infection. So let us come to practical data and talk on my current scenario of revision, data on revision surgeries. So from 2014 to 20, we have done more than 43 revision arthroplasties. That is two stage revisions. I don't recommend one stage at my practice. Two knees and 41 hips. Unfortunately, I have more than 70% of hip practice and only 30% knee. Time period has been roughly 3.2 months between first and second stage. And fortunately, my all patients are doing good. Maximum 3.5 year follow-up has been there for all the patients. Some X-rays. I'm also talking of patients in which we had some implant which were infected. So 30 gentlemen, initial days when I did not have Prostalac or the Opal-G, but something like this done and then routine THR done. And 3 months post-op, no issues. Sometimes the patients present like this where nothing has been done, but this was the case. Most of the things were done, reduction of osteotomy and everything. And patient is doing well. 2.5 year follow-up is available for the patient and absolutely fine. No evidence of pre-infection. Coming to putting a spacer. This is a case where an extended trochanteric osteotomy was done and a K-nail was bent and a cement was made and put inside. Something like this. And finally, we took out everything and did a long stem monoblock total hip replacement. When patients present with something like this, it is a clear case of infection, but everything being taken out and then you do a revision THR with a monoblock long stem. The follow-ups are good. This is one of the recent case, but managed with a short stem young patient, actually 30 years. Now, as I was telling that dynamic spaces get lost sometimes in the knee or hip, and this patient presented with something like this, infrapatellar, the cement was there, and this was done not at our place, elsewhere. Now, when I opened it, it was a huge defect, so we managed to put it with the MBT sleeves, and a post-operative outcome was like this, and the patient has been full weight bearing and no issues were there for 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. At 2 years, she had a fall and presented like this. At this junction, it was not important to do something with the processes, but we did just plating and manage the patient. So coming to this conclusion in the procedure part, revision is an effective procedure. Although the mean complication rate in literature is high, but can be minimized in the hands of experienced revision arthroplasty surgeon. And I would reiterate with my paper published in DBJS, it was 100 cases, single surgeon series, only revision. The outcomes were really good in terms of knee in single hands. So you should have an experienced surgeon who understands revision hip arthroplasty, have a system in its place. It's not a simple case. And you should have a plan, a backup plan, and a teamwork is important. So this is one of the good paper actually, the outcome reoperation rates after revision totally replacement. Now, this is again a site which I should actually send it to people. This was given by Zahar Akos, which is followed at EndoClinic. They have also an app for it. So you just feed in the stuff and they will guide you what are the stages. I mean, next step. And it is verified by the EndoClinic. So it is a very good guide for treating PGIs. Now, these are some photos with Zahar Akos. I happen to work for him and he was in Patna for the Anup Master's course and in our chamber where I am actually talking from. So Zahar Akos is one of the, he was there in Zydus meeting as well, one of the pioneers and he leads EndoClinic there at Germany. Recently, Berlin has shifted. So with this, I would like to end this fast topic of PGI, and I would be happy if you can ask question and open for discussion at this point of time. Thank you and have a great day. The references has been attached at the back.
Thank you, Ashish, for covering it so fast and comprehensively. Both were covered very well. So I have two, Dr. Salim Patel does more arthroplasty than me. I think he should begin with the questions. I have very basic questions, which I will take later.
Yeah, excellent talk, Ashish.
Thank you, sir.
Very well explained, as I know, as you are one of the most leading surgeons in Patna today, as far as arthroplasty is concerned. Yeah, so my question was, when we were doing a PG, right? So we've always been taught that infection is the biggest bug for a surgeon to handle. And it's the biggest threat for him. Right. So, as you said, you believe in a two-stage revision rather than doing a single stage.
Yes, sir.
So, my question to you is, when you plan, you've seen that the patient is infected. He's got a gross infection, like pouring pus coming out of the wound, especially if he's a diabetic. So, what would be your initial line of action? You would straight away take him up for a debridement, in which you will remove the culture and you send it, and then you analyze what is to be done. Or you would be more on the conservative side initially. What would be your line?
Sir, now let us focus back to our days when we used to discuss amongst ourselves, especially at Pune, infected non-unions. So we used to learn a classification that is Cierney and Meder classification for the patients. Okay. So in that, A is normal. I am diabetic. My diabetes was a wee bit uncontrolled. And C is HIV patient. So, in your scenario, the patient is diabetic, and his diabetes would be uncontrolled because of pouring pus, right? So, if he has got a pouring pus, I would definitely like to take him to the theater, do an aspirate, and then at that point of time, have a word with him that it is good to take out the implant and control the diabetes, or take him on sliding scale and do the implant takeout, and then put a cement spacer and do a two-stage at all costs. Because sir, it is Cierney and Meder B, immunocompromised host, and diabetes would cause other problems as well because the coding pus will not get contained in presence of metal, in presence of diabetes. In fact, it will not get contained.
So yes, along with the cement spacer, would you like to put beads as well? Antibiotic impregnated beads?
Yes, I'm sorry, I did not discuss about that. Actually, there are two types of beads. One is the antibiotic beads which you used to put earlier, and nowadays we have the beads which get absorbed. Right. I'm just not remembering the name. It's not clicking at the point of time. But yes,
biodegradable one. If I'm not mistaken.
Yes, sir. Biodegradable. Yes, sir. Right. So that can be put, sir.
You can put. Yes. That. Right.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Actually, yeah, sir, the cost becomes so high that
it is expensive.
Patna, we are struggling.
Yes, struggling.
The Kopalji cost 17,000 plus cement, right. 20,000, and this will cost 17,000.
Right. And sometimes we even used to take the antibiotic, open it, and mix it up with the cement and just put it in. In case the cost should be like vancomycin or something.
Yes, sir. Vancomycin or something. Now, one thing I would again like to tell you, sir. Now, in doing the second stage revision, especially second stage, you should avoid putting vancomycin in the cement. Like I'm doing a total hip replacement or a knee replacement second stage. Then what you do, you have bone cement, you mix vancomycin. So the hold and the property of the cement is not as good when you mix vancomycin in fixing your final prosthesis in the second stage.
Right. Yes. Excellent, Ashish. Yeah, okay, Neeraj, over to you.
Yeah, so you told about the culture reports. So I wanted to ask you, where do you take the culture from? Do you take the culture after you have opened the wound and inside deep after removing the implant? Do you send the bone piece for culture or do you send the pus for culture?
Sir, one culture is always taken in before the surgery in the theater. Like in knee, we take it like we take aspiration of the knee. And in the hips, under C-arm guidance, long needle, spinal needle type thing, or 22 gauge, we try to take out something. Actually, nothing comes from the hip most of the time. But whatever comes, I send it. Now, when you are operating, when we open it up, the fluid that comes from the capsule is always taken for culture in huge amount, as much as possible. And at the same time, I take cultures and biopsy from the almost whatever I feel is not right. But 3 biopsies I take, and from the stem 1 biopsy and from the cup 1 biopsy. And when we open, you have some fluid. Usually what happens, people suck it. But we take an injection and just pull it and send it for cultures. And
Go ahead. I thought you completed. No, you go ahead.
No, and then we ask the microbiologist at the same time that because it is second stage revision or first stage, they do gram stain. And then they go for extended cultures for 14 days. That is for sure.
Okay. Do you have had like basically when you're doing a TKR or THR, maybe the femur side and the tip, for example, a TKR, the femur side has got a different culture report and the TBR side has got a different culture report.
No, sir.
Different organism is what I'm saying.
No, sir. No. Actually, this paper, we have been working on it and I have reported all the cultures and the CSR for the 41 cases which we have done. So, cultures mostly are 60% it is no growth.
Okay.
That's another problem.
Another problem. Right.
Okay. Dr. Sushil Kumar Singh, do you have to ask him anything? Can you just unmute yourself? Just
unmute yourself. Sushil sir, unmute kar lijiye.
Yes, sir. Dr. Ashish, I would like to ask which patient we prefer in second stage or revision? Which patient we prefer for bone cement with antibiotics and which patient we prefer without antibiotics impregnated cement? In second stage revision, immunocompromised or immunocompetent patients?
Sir, there are 3 types of cement. One is bone cement without any antibiotic. One is R+G and one is simple G. G means gentamicin, rifampicin plus gentamicin. So, for all the cases we are using, this institute is gentamicin only. And rifampicin we don't use. But in cases of revision second stage, we like to use, or I have in stock what I use, that is R+G, Pelacos. And don't mix vancomycin in it. Final fixation.
In the case of competent patient, immunocompetent patients, can we go for without antibiotic mixed cement in second stage revision?
Sir, there are some papers which we can share that has show that cement, antibiotic in cement has got no role. So the consensus has to be in your hand, and I think it is better to be safe than to be sorry. And if you see the joint registry data and the type of cement used, NJR data UK, most 95% of the people are using cemented with antibiotic mix of cement like gentamicin or rifampicin and all. So we should follow the what the world is following, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, yes, so I think we are done with the questions. We thank Dr. Ashish Singh for sparing his precious time. As you can see, he's in the hospital and is working.
No,
yes. And we thank our panelists, Dr. Sushil Kumar Singh and Dr. Salim Patel. And we thank Zydus for an unrestricted educational grant. Zydus are the makers of Nucoxia, Decadurabolin, OCID QRS, and Sunbless 60K. Thank you, everyone, and good night.
Good night, sir. Good night. Good night. Good night. Good night.